Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning. We're going to make a start. Sorry for interrupting your conversations there. Yes, good morning, everyone. How are you guys going today?
Good, thank
you. That's good. Just one person feels good. The rest, a bit in the middle, eh? Yes, welcome this morning. It's great to have spent our morning together. If it's your first time here, special welcome to you. Thank you for joining us this morning. It's a great time for us to share this time together. It's great for us to share our God together as well. We do invite you to come and stay for morning tea as well, and we can have a chat and get to know you and meet you properly. If you don't know me, my name is Mario. I'll be leading us through our service today. This is Sasha. He's my little son. Before we start the service, let me tell you a little bit about our kids program. So here's an appropriate segue here. We're going to sing in a moment. After that, we'll invite kids up for a kids talk. So after that, the kids will head straight out this door, out the back, into the kids program at the boundaries of the back. So if you have kids from kindy age to grade 6, they're welcome to join us. And you're welcome to go walk them through and help them feel comfortable down there as well. So, you've actually joined us on a really good day. We're going to start our new series in Romans today. It's the second part of our series in Romans today. In the last term, we ended the term listening to Paul show us that it's not what we do that makes things right with God, but what he does for us. So, we had broken the relationship with him, but he wasn't happy with that. And he was going to reach into this world and make things right, to mend what we've broken. He sent his son Jesus to lay down his life, to pay the price that we should pay to make us right with him. God went out of his way to forgive those who didn't want him, forgive those who hated him, forgive those who were his enemies. Paul wants us to see what an amazing thing it is to behold that God dies for the ungodly, dies for those who hate them. And that's how generous a God he is. I'm just going to help us see this looking at Psalm 32, which Paul touches on in his little passage in Romans. So I'm going to read from Psalm 32. He says, I acknowledge my sin to you. I do not cover my iniquity. I said I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for him. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the ways you should go. I'll counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous. Shout for joy, all you upright in heart. To trust God is to trust that he is the one that will be generous, that trust that he's the one that will forgive. And we're going to learn more today how important that is for how we live and how we follow Jesus. So, as we do end in Psalms, we're commanded here to be right, to rejoice, to shout for joy. So let's do that as we stand and sing our first song, All Creatures, to our God and King. Please stand.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him, alleluia. Thou burning sun. sun with golden beam. Thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 Let all things their Creator bless and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 All the redeemed washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. And Christ has defeated every sin. And cast all your burdens now on Him. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Turn in power to reign. Heaven and earth will join to say, oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Then who shall fall on bended knee? All creatures of our God and King. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Dear Heavenly Father, You are glorious. You're an amazing. Yet we are not, and we are so aware of the way we fall short of You and the ways we reject You. Let's hear from Psalm 32 again. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts again. Blessed is the Lord who counts no iniquity and whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groanings all day long. For day and night Your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up by the heat of the sun. But I acknowledged my sin to You. I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and You forgave the iniquity of my sin. We confess we have rejected You. Yet in our lowest of lows, You have stood by us. You've stood for us. You've died for us. We can trust these words, and we can trust that You are good and that You are here to save us. As we sing, all this day Your hand has held me. God of heaven by my side, thank You, Father, for Your goodness. You will hold me through the night. And we pray this in Your Son's name. Amen. We keep singing the night song.
In the darkness, God will keep me here. will stay and never sleep. In the darkness, God is brighter. Though the night is long and deep, all this day your hand has held me, God of heaven by my side. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. You will hold me through the night. In the shadows you are with me, and you know my every fear. In the shadows none can harm me, for the mighty King is here. All this day your hand has held me, God of heaven by my side. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. You will hold me through the night. So I find my rest in Jesus, He who came to rescue me. Jesus saved me from the darkness. I will rise to life with Him. All this day your hand has held me, God of heaven by my side. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. You will hold me through the night. All this day your hand has held me, God of heaven by my side. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. You will hold me through the night. You will hold me through the night.
Please be seated. Chris is going to come up and give us a kids talk. If all the kids are ready and willing, please form a little orderly pile over here.
I'll give the kids a few moments to get settled. Ellie, well, that might be a bit too far forward. I might accidentally stand on... Hello, kids. How are you all this morning? Good? You all look a bit sleepy still. Still recovering from the holidays? You're not sleepy? No. Well, guys, I need some answers from you. So if I ask a question, just shout out yes or no or an answer that you might have, because I've got 3 or 4 questions for you to ask. So the first one is, if I was to tell you that in summer, now we're going into winter, but in summer, if I was to tell you in summer you would go to the beach, would you believe me? Yes. Yes? Yeah? Do you reckon in summer at least once you might go to the beach? Yeah, I think that's most of you are mumbling a bit of a yes. All right, the next one is, if I was to tell you that in summer you would go to Buckingham Palace to visit the King personally and greet him and say hello, would you believe me?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, some very confident kids. Yes, no. I think that might not happen. I'm not going to make any promises there. What if I was to say that in summer... If I was to tell you that in summer, NASA chose you to go on their newest Kids to the Moon mission, and in summer you would go visit outer space, would you believe me? I think some of you are being a bit cheeky there. Look, wouldn't that be a wonderful, wonderful thing? But I'm not sure that they even run that mission. What? Now, this is the last one. What if I was to tell you that when you died, you would go to live with Jesus and God in heaven? That's a pretty big thought, isn't it? Those other two were pretty unbelievable. Now, I put that one last because the beach was believable, but was Buckingham Palace believable or outer space? Not really. But the idea of heaven is so magnificent and so great that sometimes it can feel a bit unbelievable. When we're down here on earth and heaven's all the way up there, it can feel a bit unbelievable, but God promises us that if we choose to love and obey him and follow him with our heart, we'll belong with him up there. Now, do you know why that's particularly amazing to be in heaven? It's because this world's a little bit broken, isn't it? There's some pretty sad things that happen in this world. It can be something as small as grazing your knee, or maybe a bully picked on you at school, or it could be something awful like a war or a natural disaster. There's lots of bad things that happen in this world. But that's what's so amazing about heaven, because God has sent his Son to save us. And he's going to one day make this world new again. But he wants all of you to join him in heaven and to be with him and to save you. And that's why we learned about Jesus' death. Girls, sit back, please. That's why we learned about Jesus' death at Easter time. Because he took away all our sins so that one day we can be in perfect heaven where there is no grazed knees or earthquakes or bullies. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Now, God shared this amazing promise with us, so I think it's really important for us to share that wonderful news with our friends, because we want everyone to know God, because God wants everyone to join him in heaven. So I want you to think about that, because that's not going to happen today. I hope not. For you guys. Sorry. I mean, no, I hope it does. But at the same time, we want our friends to know about it so that they can prepare and they can learn to love God so that one day they'll also be with God in heaven too. So I'm going to get you to close your eyes and I'm going to quickly pray for you. So dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the wonderful promise that you have shared with us. I pray that you will help us get ready for that wonderful day when we will join with you in heaven. And I pray that we will also share this good news with our friends so that they can also know you and know of your wonderful gift in Jesus Christ. I pray. Amen. All right, guys, you're going to learn more about that in Kids Church. So I think you're all heading out the back. And we'll see you after the service. Have a great time.
Well, good morning and welcome to Graceville Presbyterian Church. My name is Rohan, if I haven't met you before, and it's wonderful to have you join us for our 8:30 service today. Today we're going to be kicking off our next part of the series through the book of Romans, so looking forward to that as we pick up from the middle of chapter 5. And as you came through the door this morning, you would have seen our new growth group booklets are available for this term. And so even if you're not part of a growth group, you're welcome to take one of those. They might help you in your own quiet times, reflections on God's word through the week. And if you would like to be part of a growth group, well, it's a new term and they're kicking off this week. Growth groups are a wonderful opportunity to meet with other believers here from church during the week, and we look at the Bible passage that's coming up on the next Sunday or we've done in the previous Sunday. We think about it, discuss it together, what it means for our lives, and we pray for one another to support one another in the Christian life. There's lots of different times of groups available, And so come and have a chat to me if you'd like to be involved in one of those this term. But they'll be kicking off from this week. So if you're part of a growth group, look out for a message from your leaders as to the details for those kicking off this week. And please grab one of the growth group booklets on your way out. We have either A5 ones or A4 ones, larger ones, so whatever you prefer. So that's growth groups kicking off this week. Not today, but next Sunday, we're having a Connect lunch. And so I want to invite anyone who's joined us here at Graceville, say over the past 6 months, or maybe you haven't been to one of these before. It's really a way of just having a simple introduction into who we are as a church here, what our mission is, we can answer any questions that you might have about our church. It's meant to be a basic introduction to our church and also just a relaxed lunch together to meet others who are new to church as well. So that's happening next Sunday at Tricia and Ian Preston's place over at Sherwood. If you could let me know if you're able to make it along, that'd be wonderful, and we'd love to see you next Sunday. So those are the main announcements for today, and we're going to have a time of prayer now. Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. There will be a short pause of 15 seconds for you to pray silently. Abba Father, thank you for this morning when we can gather together as your children, washed and cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Some of us come with hearts full of praise and thanksgiving. Some are here with heavy hearts of burdens and cares. And some are full of pain and heartaches, which only you know. Father, we lay all this bare before you. No matter what our circumstances, you know, you understand, and you feel with us. Come, Holy Spirit, touch us, we pray. We'll pause now. Fill us afresh, Lord. May we sense your hand upon us and set us free to worship you, for you alone are worthy. Thank you for this blessed country. Thank you for fresh, clean air, for every breath we take into our lungs, for the complexity of our bodies, which work in perfect harmony. Father, we acknowledge that you are the giver of life, the source of our countless blessings. Thank you for working in our world. In the midst of problems, chaos, and calamities, we see your handiwork and glimpses of your glory. For you, O Lord, has made us glad by what you have done. We will sing for joy at the works of your hands. We confess that so often we thank you for the roses and forget to thank you for the thorns. We lose balance, perhaps by a phone call, an email, or sudden news. We become fearful, disturbed, and hastily we respond with our own wisdom. Lord, forgive us. Remind us to pause and pray and commit those situations to you. And be ready to listen to your counsel, to trust you to bring us to a broad place of safety and security. For you will keep us in perfect peace, whose mind is steadfast on you. Remember those who are facing health challenges, work pressures, tensions at home, and loneliness. We pray that their turbulent spirit will find rest in your deep, deep river of love, for you long to be gracious and compassionate to each one of us. Your word promises that you will reach down from on high and take hold of our hand. We pray for our church missionaries who serve in Thailand, Japan, South Africa, and in uni campuses. May they be filled with the knowledge of your will in their respective work. May they continue to walk steadfastly before you. We pray for the marshals in Japan, especially today, as they prepare to return home for home assignment. Pray that you will shower them with wisdom as they will soon hand over the work to another person. We pray for good health and sustenance. May they rest in you and trust you for all their needs. Jesus, you are the good shepherd. We trust in your abundant provisions for them in due course. We also pray for the many prodigals who have known and believed in you, but have since drifted away from fellowship. You love them, and we pray that we also will love them, and that they will come to their senses and return to your loving embrace. Thank you for the many varied outreach ministries in the church throughout the year. We ask that you will give us creative ways to connect with our friends and folks we know, and be on the alert to watch out for opportunities to invite them to such events. Jesus, you came to save and to seek the lost. Please use us to be channels of your love and be ready to welcome them into our midst. In the scriptures, it is written, "For I am God and there is no other. I am God and there's no one like me." Declaring the end from the beginning, from ancient times, things which have not been done, saying, "My purpose will be established and I will accomplish all my good pleasure." Lord, we are yours, the sheep of your pasture. May we take delight in our day-to-day walk with you, trusting you to work and to bring to pass all that you desire in us and through us, to bring you glory and praise. We commit all our praise to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So just before we dive back into Romans, let us remind ourselves of the wonderful gift we receive in Jesus, the depths of his love that wins us our forgiveness, our peace, and our reconciliation with God. So it brings us from death to life, brings us from slave to free. Let us sing, "Yet not I, but through Christ in me." Let's stand and sing.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold. My hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus, now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Grab a seat, everyone.
Good morning. Our Bible reading today is from Romans chapter 5, verse 9 to 21, and the words will come up on the screen. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people, because all sinned, to be sure, sin was in this world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as did Adam, who is a pattern of the one to come. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as though the disobedience of the one man the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man the many will be made righteous. The law was brought in so that the trespass might increase. But where sin increased, grace increased all the more, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness to bring eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Be great if you could keep that passage open as we come to reflect on that in a moment, but let's bring our time before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this book of Romans, this ancient letter which is inspired by your Holy Spirit and speaks to us today, just as it did for those first readers. We pray this morning that your Holy Spirit would open our hearts and minds to receive what you're saying to us, that we would hear your voice, and that we would obey your voice, trusting in the Lord Jesus, our Saviour. And we pray this all in his name. Amen. Well, it's just under 2 weeks until the coronation day, the coronation of our new king, King Charles. For the first time in 70 years, a new monarch will be crowned, and Charles's reign will officially begin. We'll have a new king. Now, Charles will reign over Britain. He'll reign over the nations of the Commonwealth, and he'll reign over us. These days, the office of king, as we all know, is largely symbolic. We live in a constitutional monarchy, and we have a parliament that makes our decisions, really. But the king is still technically our head of state. And as our king, Charles could make decisions, maybe through our parliaments, which will affect us. The reality is we didn't choose Charles as our king. We don't have a say in the decisions he or his servants make, but he is our king. We live under his reign. And today in Romans chapter 5, we're going to see two completely opposite rulers that we can live under. The reign of sin and death through Adam, or God's gracious offer to reign in life under our true king, the Lord Jesus. Like King Charles, we don't get a say in the decisions of our king, but we'll see that we can choose which king we live under. Now, today marks the beginning of part two in our journey through the book of Romans. This letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Rome just a couple of decades after Jesus rose from the dead. And this church, well, they're believers like us facing challenges, the challenges of following Jesus in a hostile culture. And Paul wants to remind them and us of God's life-changing gospel, the good news about Jesus, which he said right at the very beginning is the power of God that brings salvation to all who believe. Now, last term, we saw how God makes us right through Christ. Despite how sinful we all are, whether we're religious or not, we saw how righteous God is, whether we recognize him or not. And we saw how God graciously justifies or makes us righteous by the death of Jesus on our behalf, if we'll receive his gift of life through faith. In chapter 4 of Romans, Paul used the Old Testament example of Abraham to show that's always how God has saved sinful people, by faith, not by anything we do. And then we got to chapter 5 at the end of last term. We paused our hard run through the book of Romans to stop and enjoy the view. In chapter 5 there, we marvel, we take in the view of what God has done for us in Jesus and enjoy all that we have in the gospel, how we have peace with God, how we stand in his grace. We have a unique hope that we cling to even amid suffering, and we have the wonderful assurance that God loves us. He proved that love to us when he died on the cross. And while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. As we saw at the start of our reading today from verse 9, that should also give us great assurance about our future salvation. Since we've now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? But that's where we run into a problem. It's great to say we're justified through Christ, but our lived experience in this world is still sin and death. Every morning when we wake up and we look in the mirror, a sinner is staring straight back at me. And That's what we struggle with day by day. As sin rears its head in our lives, as the reality of its consequence of death still hangs over us, the world seems dark and deadly. So it's easy for our lived experience of sin and death to cast a shadow of doubt on our hope and our joy about being reconciled with God. How can we be sure of that? Well, this term, in chapters 5 to 11, Paul wants us to see how this gospel, which yes, makes us right through Christ, also transforms our lived experience of being a Christian, the Christian life. We're made alive in Christ. And so even amidst our day-to-day experience with sin and death, we can live with confidence and assurance because of what Jesus has done for us. The foundation for this new life that we have in Christ is what we'll look at today in the second half of chapter 5. Here, Paul contrasts these two different reigns. So that again, we see the incredible assurance that is ours in the gospel. And we're going to look at it in three parts: the reign of death, the reign of life, and choosing the superior reign. So Paul starts with the bad news. Through Adam, we're all under the reign of death. It's there in verse 12. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. Paul kind of pulls back the curtain here and exposes this huge problem which is confronting the entire human race. It goes right back to the very beginning of the Bible in Genesis chapter 3, where we see the fall of humanity. And there's three steps he lays out here for our downfall. Step one. Sin entered the world through one man. It's there at the beginning of the verse. Sin came into the world through this one man, Adam. Adam was the father of all humanity. He was God's appointed ruler to take care of the creation. He was the representative ruler of all people, Paul's saying here. But Adam foolishly disobeyed God's command. The command was clear, do not eat from the tree. But Adam didn't trust God's wisdom. Like us, he thought he knew better. He wanted to be like God. But the enslaving power of sin immediately mastered Adam. And from that moment on, everything changed. Not only for Adam, but sin entered the world through this one man. And it came with devastating consequences. Step two, death came through sin. God did what he said he'd do. He expelled the man and the woman from the source of his life in the garden. They rejected God, they rejected his goodness and life, he's the source of those things. And so he was just to cut humanity off from life-giving relationship with him in the garden. And so as the power of sin invaded our world, death came riding in on its coattails. Because death is unavoidable, it can seem kind of like, oh, it's just a natural part of life. But actually, death is unnatural. It's an unwelcome intruder into our world, into our lives. And we feel that when someone we love dies. When we go to a funeral, when we feel the grief and sadness, and we know just instinctively, this is not right. This is not how things are meant to be. Death doesn't belong here. But the reality of sin means, step one, sin entered the world through one man. Step two, death came through sin. And step three, death now reigns over all, because all sinned. The curse of death has spread to all people, in all times, everywhere. None of us can escape death through our strength or our success or our notoriety in life. Sooner or later, it's the fate that awaits us all. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, in this way death came to all people. Why? Because all sinned. Now, it's interesting. Paul doesn't say here that all sin like Adam did. It's not like we're just following Adam's bad example. He's saying here that in Adam, we all sinned. And this is where we get this whole doctrine that's called original sin. Just like we were born with traits of our parents, we all inherit the sin of our original forefather, Adam. We're not sinners because we sin, but we sin because we're sinners. It's in our nature. It's ingrained in us from birth. Just as Charles is about to reign over us as king, whether we like it or not, Adam is our representative head. for all people throughout history. His decision to disobey God impacts all of us. Paul's saying here, what's true of Adam? Well, then it's going to be true of us. Adam sinned and Adam died. All the rest of us sinned and all the rest of us came under the reign of death. Now, that might seem unfair to us. I mean, Adam made a pretty bad decision. But as Tim Keller says, Adam was perfectly created and designed to act exactly as you, personally, the way that you would have acted as an individual in the same situation. See, none of us would have done anything differently to Adam because God made him to be our perfect representative, or imperfect, we should say. In our Western culture, we don't like this idea, the idea of other people making decisions for us. Kind of grates against us. We think we're independent people, individuals. But actually, in reality, we're far more interdependent than we imagine. We can all think of decisions our parents made, say about where we would live or where we would go to school or how we were brought up. And those things have a significant impact on us. Maybe that impact continues through life. If you're an employee in a company and that company goes and merges with another company, you probably weren't in the room negotiating that deal. That was the job of the company leadership, but their decision has an impact on you. It impacts the whole firm. Our democracy is built on the principle of representation. We have a House of Representatives in Canberra. And if tomorrow our Prime Minister decides we're going to go to war against New Zealand, well, then the whole nation is at war with New Zealand. See, Adam, as our federal head, it's not that much of an unfamiliar concept to us. And yet the tragic consequence of his decisions is that now we're all under the reign of sin and death. Now, next in verse 13, Paul takes a bit of a diversion here to talk about something that his Jewish readers would have been asking about. Wasn't the problem of sin solved by the law of Moses? Well, Paul says in verse 13, to be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account where there is no law. Back in Romans 1-3, we saw that we're all guilty of sin, whether we've got the law or not. The law just highlights our sin more clearly. It's like if I climb over my neighbour's fence and start swimming in their pool. I think we all know there's something wrong about that. It's not quite right. But if they've put a big sign up on the fence saying no trespassing, well, then we're not in any doubt. It's clear what my crime is. It's trespassing. Paul concedes the law highlighted sin in a way that hadn't happened before, but sin was always there. It was always there in the heart. And he returns quickly to his main point in verse 14. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam, right at the very beginning, to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as Adam did, who is a pattern of one to come. So he's saying here the reign of death is extensive. Ever since Adam, it's been reigning. So whether we broke a specific command like he did, or like the Israelites did with the Ten Commandments, we're all under the power of sin. We're all under the reign of death. It's just a matter of time. So this week, we remember and we give thanks for those who've served our country in war. But even if you think of those who fought bravely in the Gallipoli campaign, even if they survived that horror, there's not a single Anzac alive today, just over 100 years later. The last surviving Anzac died back in 2002. And if we were to fast forward 100 years from now, well, I very much doubt many of us will be alive at that point either. Death reigns over us all. And that's the bad news about having a representative head. His bad decision has had terrible consequences for the rest of us. But the good news is it works the other way too. The first Adam brought the reign of death, but the second Adam brings the reign of life. Have a look at verse 15. The gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? If you think death's bad under the reign of sin, well, in Adam, where we're all responsible, how good is it to be gifted life? To be gifted life by God's amazing grace to us in Jesus. Jesus' offer of life is a gift we can't claim any responsibility in. And yet for all who trust in Jesus, the extraordinary benefits of his actions overflow to the many. He becomes our new representative head. That's why God became one of us, the man, Christ Jesus. So Paul here does what's called a kind of lesser to the greater argument. If we thought what we did was bad, messing up the whole world by our sin, well, how much greater is God's goodness in fixing up that mess? It's always harder to be a fixer than to be a wrecker. And I can tell you this as a parent of small children. It takes a lot more effort to clean up the mess, whether it's drawing on the furniture, painting on the walls, toilet accidents, than the 2 seconds it took my child to create the problem. It's always harder to be a fixer than to be a wrecker. Paul tells us here, we're the wreckers, but God is the fixer. If we dreaded the reign of the first Adam, well, how much more are we going to be free under the management of the second Adam? The overflow of grace is far more powerful than the spreading of death. Paul's showing here how the gift of righteousness is not like the trespass. And by trespass, he means the breaking of God's command, as Adam did originally. Death came to all people because in Adam we all sinned, but grace overflows to the many because in Jesus, only by Jesus, God gives us the gift of his righteousness. Verse 16, nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. So Paul's saying here, if you compare the two, you've got condemnation versus justification. It's incomparable. One sin brought the whole house down in judgment and left us in that terrible state. But justification is gifted. After our huge pile of sins are taken away and we're made right in Christ. One sin did massive damage, but one grace gift in Jesus can undo it all. A few years ago, one of our children was sick in the night, and so Heather and I went in to change over their sheets, clean them up, and in the rush, I threw the sheets into the laundry sink, which was upstairs, and turned on the tap to just have them rinsing. And we put the child back to bed, we settled down to watch some TV, and we were relaxing there when about half an hour later we had a homestay student staying with us at the time, and she didn't have much English, but she ran up the stairs and started saying, water, water, water. all right, we better come down and have a look. And we were confronted by the sight of water pouring through the light fittings and through the ceiling. There was serious damage to be done. That took a lot of effort to clean up. In fact, a year or two later before we did a full house renovation, and that was when the issue was finally dealt with. Now, if you compare the two, the destruction versus the renovation, well, they're quite different, aren't they? The destruction didn't take long again, but it brought extensive damage. The renovation took longer, it cost more, but its benefits were on a far greater scale. It not only fixed up the damage, but it improved our house. It made it look better. It made it function better. And that's the kind of comparison Paul's making here. You've got the reign of death through Adam, bringing destruction to the entire human race, versus the reign of life that brings grace and justification through Christ. He takes things a step further in verse 17. For if by the trespass of the one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? Notice what's promised here to those who receive what God is offering us in Christ, his abundant provision of grace. Not just that Jesus will reign in life, but actually all of us who trust in him, Christians, will get to share in that reign with him. In Adam, death reigned over us, but in Jesus, how much more will we reign in life with him, with Christ? So what does this mean? Well, I think it means we no longer, when we come to Christ, trapped in the slavery of sin and death, but instead we share in the benefits that our risen and conquering King has won for us as his people. He's cleansed us from our sins, and so we have the privilege to share in his heavenly inheritance. As Paul puts later on in Romans 8, we become heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, just what Carissa was talking about earlier in the kids' talk. It's this great hope that's ours in the gospel. No longer under the reign of death, we reign in life through the second Adam. Paul sums up these contrasts between Adam and Christ's reign in verses 18 and 19. Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. Paul's argument here is a one-to-many kind of argument. By the one act of our representative, that has consequences for the many. Just like the PM declaring war or, say, the Reserve Bank putting up interest rates, we didn't get a say in these decisions, but they impact us for better or for worse. Thanks be to God, our justification and life do not depend on what I do or what you do. The only thing that makes us justified before God is the one righteous, obedient act of Jesus, our new representative head. Now, Jesus' obedience, well, we see his perfect obedience in his life. We see the way that he loved others with extraordinary compassion, the way he always did his Father's will, the way he remained faithful to God's commands even under extreme temptation. And we see Jesus' obedience most fully in his death on the cross, where he followed the Father's plan of salvation right to the end at unimaginable cost and sacrifice. And Paul promises the good news for all who trust in Jesus, for the many who trust in him as Saviour, we can be made righteous, justified and given life forever through him. The obedience of the one man, Jesus, benefiting the many who submit to his reign of life. So just as the disobedience of the one man, Adam, brought the reign of sin and death to many, so the actions of Jesus and his obedience bring life to many. And this brings us to an important choice each of us have. See, as I said earlier, we don't make the decisions of our head, but we do have a choice about whose reign we want to live under. And Paul sums it up for us in the last few verses. The law was brought in so that the trespass might increase. But where sin increased, grace increased all the more. So that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness to bring eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. See, sin enslaves us. The law just really highlights the reality of our sin. But God's grace to us in Christ is far superior. Where sin increases, spreading to humanity in every direction, causing ruin to our lives. And we know this, don't we? Sin causes ruin to our everyday experience of life, to our relationships, to our life in this world. We struggle under the reign of sin and death. Yes, sin is a huge problem, far more serious than we often imagine. But God's grace, far more powerful, far superior. His undeserved kindness shown to us by sending us the new and better Adam, the Lord Jesus, who was sent to us to bring us life and the gift of his righteousness, so that we would reign in life with him. We sing it in that song, our sins, they are many, but his mercy is more. Or as this old Puritan pastor put it, there is more grace in Jesus than there is sin in me. It's good news, isn't it? The wonderful superiority of Jesus' reign compared to Adam's. About 9 years ago, our family made a big decision to move up here to Brisbane to do ministry here at Graceville Presbyterian Church. And I remember in the kind of 6 months beforehand when we were trying to make this decision, I remember a day where we kind of pulled out a piece of paper and we wrote down all the pros and cons. How can we make a wise decision here? How can we weigh it all up? And the move seemed worth it, and so we made that hard decision to leave behind what we knew. But as I look back, I kind of wish I could go back there and edit my comparison table, because I reckon now it was actually a no-brainer. Life in Queensland is far better. I can guarantee that. We're part of a wonderful church. We live in a lovely community. We enjoy life here, and we're still here 8.5 years later. It is hard to let go of our roots at state of origin time. But apart from then, we're very convinced of our decision. As we get to Romans 5 here, stand back and think about what it means for our lives. Paul's showing us here the comparison table between the reign of death under Adam and the reign of life in Christ. And it really is a no-brainer as you look through the list of what we get here. In Adam, we get sin and death and condemnation. We see his disobedience and sin increasing and reigning over us, the reign of death. In Christ, well, we're given righteousness, eternal life, justification. We see his perfect obedience that brings grace abounding to us, and we reign in life with Christ as our head and saviour. So what are we going to do in response? Well, first I want to say, if you're not yet someone who trusts Christ as your head, if you haven't come under his reign, if you haven't given your life to him, can I urge you to do so? It is the superior reign. Come under the reign of Christ. Or walk over the demilitarized zone, to put it one way. Change rulers from being in Adam to being in Christ, shifting the allegiance of your heart to him. Repent and believe the good news that you too can reign in life with Christ. You can have forgiveness of sins. You can have eternal life simply by trusting in him as your king. Secondly, if you've already put your trust in Jesus as your king, well, I think this passage should challenge the way that we see the world. As you go to work on a Monday morning or go off to uni or go and catch up with your friends, I think Paul's challenging us here to recognise, actually, when it really boils down to it, there are two categories of people in the world. Not Jew or Gentile, liberal or Labour, hard left or hard right, not rich or poor, male or female, but those who are in Adam and those who are in Christ. Those trapped under the reign of death and those who by grace reign in life. It's helpful for us to see these two clear categories, not to burden us with guilt, but to challenge us to see we have a wonderful gift, God's abundant provision of grace to share with the world. We thought about that this week. We had a great discussion at our How to Share Jesus with Our Friends Equip Night. And if you didn't get a chance to catch that, please have a watch of it on our YouTube page. It's so important for us as Christians to think about how do we share our faith in Jesus, because it's only in the gospel, the power of God for salvation, that people can transfer from being in the reign of death under Adam to being in the beautiful, life-saving reign of Christ. So we have a clear gospel mission, and this passage urges us to see that mission very clearly, to see the opportunity before us to share the good news of what we've found in Christ. And I think thirdly, what do we do with this passage? Well, we can be thankful, can't we? That by the amazing grace of God, we have life in Christ. Grace that has overflowed to the many, not because of anything we did, because of God graciously sending us a new Adam, the second Adam, the best Adam of all, and that we've come under his reign through trusting in him by the grace of God. The old hymn writer Isaac Watts puts it this way, "In Christ the tribes of Adam boast, more blessings than their father lost. By grace, we are under the far superior reign." So let's enjoy it and let's give thanks for what we have in Christ, our second Adam. Let me lead us in prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you this morning for your incredible grace. All of us, all humanity, were stuck under the reign of sin and death, with its terrible consequences that we still taste each and every day. Father, we thank you for sending us a Redeemer. Thank you for sending us the Saviour, a new Adam, a new head to lead us out of sin, out of death, into life and forgiveness. Father, we pray this morning you'd help each of us to trust in Jesus as our Saviour, to come out from the reign of sin and death and enjoy life in him. And Father, having been given that life, help us to be bold in wanting to share it with the people around us, and help us to give thanks to you for what's ours, not by what we've done, not by our own efforts, but simply by grace. And we give you thanks for all this in the Lord Jesus' name. Amen.
We come and join with us as we sing, Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery. Thank you.
wondrous mystery in the dawning of the King. He, the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Come behold the wondrous mystery, He the perfect Son of Man. In His living, in His suffering, never trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save the hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law, in Him we stand. Come behold the wondrous mystery, Christ the Lord upon the tree. In the stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured, love untold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death the God of life. But no grave could e'er restrain Him, praise the Lord, He is alive. And what a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when He comes. And what a foretaste of deliverance, how unwavering our hope. Christ in power resurrected, as we will be when He comes.
What a foretaste of our deliverance. I hope unwavering. We're going to end our time now as we are with these words from Hebrews 13. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, that we have so much to give thanks for through you and your grace to us. Amen. Everyone, please be seated. We're going to have a bit of time of morning tea. Please join us.